I'm really excited to be here today and to be presenting to you about boreal woodland caribou and how I believe that they could be, their conservation can also provide benefits to us as a nature-based climate solution. So I'll be sharing today a little bit about who CPAWS is. Sorry, my cat has joined. what nature-based climate solutions are, the potential that we have in Canada and Alberta's boreal forest to use nature as a climate solution, and what those overlaps with boreal woodland caribou conservation is. He's persistent. So first off, the Canadian Parks and Wilderness Society is a nationwide charitable nonprofit organization with a vision of protecting public lands and waters all across Canada and in our oceans as well. And so far, this organization, since its inception in 1963, has led the way in conserving total area across Canada, roughly the size of the Yukon Territory, which is incredible. We are also an organization that, one of Canada's only organizations that solely focuses on protection of just public lands and waters, which in Canada makes up about 90% of the land base. And we're also a unique organization in that we have independently operated regional chapters in almost every province and territory. So I am joining you from CPAWS Northern Alberta. Our office is based in Edmonton on Treaty 6 lands. And we are looking out for Alberta from roughly Red Deer north to the Northwest Territories border is our jurisdiction, if you will. And we are a pretty small office. There's only 6 full-time staff, which is a great team to work in. And everything we do is founded in science. We have a very collaborative approach with Indigenous groups and communities, governments of all levels, and other members of the public and environmental organizations. So we'll get into it. What are nature-based climate solutions? I saw Teresa in that last presentation touched on it a little bit. But according to Environment and Climate Change Canada, nature-based climate solutions are actions to conserve or sustainably manage or restore ecosystems in ways that will help store and capture carbon, mitigate the impacts of climate change, so build resiliency or improve water quality, and as well with that nature aspect to provide critical habitat for Canada's wildlife. In 2020, conservation and climate experts from across the country, including myself, came together to discuss nature-based climate solutions and really jointly agreed that they could have and will have a huge impact for Canadian climate action and as well to address the biodiversity crisis. And in Northern Alberta and really across Northern Canada, it's quite clear that our boreal forest presents an opportunity for those nature-based climate solutions. So we've got 270 million hectares of boreal made up of swamps, bogs, meadows, forests of different types, rivers and lakes. And a large part of the boreal forest is wetlands and peatlands, which contain and absorb a lot of greenhouse gas, meaning that they can help combat climate change. The boreal forest stores all of the CO2 underground in its soils. And if we have a look at this map that I've put up here in Canada, you can see that we have really high areas of soil organic carbon. So the warmer colors across this map are indicating higher concentrations. And in Northern Alberta, in the boreal, we can see that we have a lot, which means potential for climate action. I'm not sure if you can see my cursor, but I'm currently pointing at kind of the Fort McMurray area, the Keyano College region there, which has high potential, but as well as the remainder of the area. Interestingly, a well As well, the boreal forest has more carbon storage potential than tropical or temperate forests globally, and can provide an important role in regulating climate. And while it's true that tropical forests have more sequestration potential due to, you know, warmer, moister climates with high productivity, quick growing times, and quick turnover, the carbon stored in the boreal has a much longer storage time due to those longevity of the cycles. So this in our boreal forest makes conservation of the landscapes and maintenance of the intactness of our forests more important for climate solutions. More important perhaps than, you know, planting trees and growing trees. However, the restoration of ecosystems across our forest will still prove important for those biodiversity and climate impacts in Canada. Unfortunately for our boreal and for wildlife and climate action, our boreal forest has changed tremendously over time. And to have those climate benefits, it's really important that it's intact. But our boreal is a really busy landscape. There's many competing industrial and recreational interests that have harmed it and disturbed it and have been rampant for decades. Our busy landscapes are complicated to manage, as I'm sure many of you are aware or involved in industries that really rely on accessing those resources that the boreal contains, like oil and gas extraction, exploration, transportation, and forest harvest. But these disturbances are pervasive and at a massive scale, and you can even see them from space. So why is this disturbance relevant to nature-based climate solutions? While the landscape level disturbances have caused or will cause large quantities of greenhouse gas emissions just from the land disturbance itself. So for example, to date, nearly 2,000 square kilometers of peatland, some of the boreal's most carbon-rich lands, have been disturbed by oil and gas exploration. And just the land disturbance of this has released 4.4 to 5.1 kilotons of methane into the atmosphere, or which is equivalent to about 30,000 passenger cars on the road for 1 year. And this is just the exploration. In this graphic here, if we pop down a line and examine the landscape level impacts of the oil sands, modeled from 2012 to 2030, we could expect up to 182 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions just from the ecosystem disturbances. It's important to note that the disturbances to peatlands is effectively irreversible due to the low productivity and the extremely long timeline it takes for peatlands to become peatlands. This is all to say that greenhouse gas emissions, not to mention the lost sequestration opportunity and lost intactness of the forest in nature, is important to consider when we're planning our climate action activities. By reducing the industrial footprint on the ecosystems through conservation or changing management regimes or restoring landscapes, we could substantially reduce the greenhouse gas emissions and biodiversity impacts that result when those natural landscapes are changed or degraded. So this is a really interesting figure. It's looking at natural climate solutions and their global potential. And it's really highlighting that there's a lot of gains to come from protecting intact areas from loss, from just changing management regimes. You know, if we're having a forest management area, perhaps not harvesting in those high carbon areas, or also restoring native forests. So why are we comparing caribou conservation to nature-based climate solutions? Boreal woodland caribou are found in almost every province and territory across Canada. They're different from their Arctic counterparts that we see, you know, on planet Earth in their giant herds migrating impressive distances, but the boreal caribou really prefer smaller herds. They don't migrate very much. And they really like those boggy wetlands and old growth forests that we were just talking about for safety and food. Boreal woodland caribou are also incredibly sensitive to industrial disturbance, which has been driving their decline for decades. And they were finally listed on the Species at Risk Act in 2003. And we can use boreal caribou population health as almost a proxy for the health of the boreal forest. And their range overlaps almost the entire extent of the boreal. So this is caribou range in pink and the boreal zone in green. This other really interesting map is current caribou range in green and soil organic carbon in intact landscapes in the brown gradient, with darker brown being higher soil organic carbon. Boreal woodland caribou heavily favor these lowland habitats containing peatlands, which again are some of the world's most dense carbon stores. The total estimated stock of soil organic carbon summed across the entire range of all woodland caribou, including the already impacted portions of their ranges, is 129 gigatons, which is more than half of all of the carbon stocks estimated for the Canadian boreal forest biome. Judging by this, we could see that there'd be great natural climate solution benefits to conserving caribou due to that overlap. Unfortunately, our caribou populations here in Alberta are not healthy. They're not self-sustaining, which again is indicating a challenge in our forests. We have 15 woodland caribou herds on provincial lands, with all of them in decline. You can see from this figure here, each line represents a different herd in Alberta. And the change in the percent change in their population from 2000 to 2016. And you can see all of them have been facing rapid declines. And to get into why that is happening, we have to understand their survival strategies. So caribou are specialized and they're super sensitive to landscape changes, both anthropogenic, so human-caused disturbances, but also natural, such as wildfire. And historically, they've had large ranges, which has reduced the risk of predation on them by allowing them to have low population densities and to use areas of their range to avoid predation. And again, they use these, you know, musk eggs, bodies of water, and mature old growth forests to avoid predators. Unfortunately, these strategies of predator avoidance in dense, boggy, intact areas fail when their ranges are highly disturbed by industrial activity. And as we've seen, the boreal is a really competitive landscape with oil and gas activities, forest harvest, recreation uses, and this cumulative impact of all of these different disturbances on top of each other is really driving caribou decline. And this is an aerial photo of the boreal. And when we view ranges from the air or mapped, it's not hard to see why these cumulative impacts are so damaging to their survival. You can also visualize this disturbance to caribou range and habitat on a map. This is one of the hardest hit ranges in Alberta, in the Little Smoky area, which is in west central Alberta. And the tiny dark green patches are remaining undisturbed habitat. The rest there is seismic lines, forest harvest, well pads, etc. And while this is one of the worst, like horribly disturbed, ranges in Alberta, this trend is pretty similar across all of our 15 caribou herds. So the main mechanism for their decline is all of those seismic lines, roads, and cut blocks that we saw in those last few slides, which provide better habitat for alternate prey species such as moose or deer, which helps increase their population, which in turn increases wolf and other predator populations. And these linear features also make hunting faster and easier for predators. Example here, we have a natural forest cover and an old seismic line. And studies have shown that wolves can move 3 times faster down those seismic lines, which it's no surprise how that can improve their ability to hunt for caribou. So where are we now and what are we doing about it? And how does helping caribou help climate? Can you guys see this? The slide is not showing up for me. Okay, that was weird. Sorry about that. To help caribou, we have a habitat conservation target that was determined federally and supported by a scientific assessment and recently retested that found in order to have a chance of survival, caribou need to have at least 65% of their range undisturbed and intact. So this allows for a 35% disturbance limit. Right now, you can see in this graph that no caribou herds meet this threshold, which is that red line across it. All of them have much more both anthropogenic disturbance and natural disturbance, such as wildfires, than they can handle. And this habitat target is great because, as we saw previously, there's a lot of overlap with natural carbon stores that we would like to conserve and keep in the ground. So habitat protection and restoration is obviously needed to recover Alberta's caribou, which can contribute to the conservation of those important boreal caribou, boreal carbon sinks, which would prevent further loss of natural carbon storage and provide benefits to biodiversity. As well, the conservation of these boreal lowlands can provide essential fresh water management and storage, which, as we've heard, water management is going to be increasingly important into our future, and can increase the resiliency to fire and flood, as well as provide associated biodiversity benefits to all of the other boreal species that call these areas home. Unfortunately, the action for caribou has been really slow. There was a recovery strategy released by the federal government in 2012. This mandated that provinces and territories should have action plans or range plans to provide a pathway for the recovery within 5 years. Those have not happened. They haven't been completed or implemented. In fact, since 2012, we've seen not only continued habitat loss for caribou across the boreal, but it's actually accelerated. And this was a paper that was released in last year, 2021, showing that across Alberta and BC, that net habitat change. So you can see in that kind of teal color, Alberta has been losing habitat more than almost any other caribou range. So we do have a small light at the end of the tunnel for caribou. Alberta in the last few years has been addressing the needs for access management within caribou range through sub-regional plans that includes caribou ranges as well as adjacent landscapes. And these have been informed by task forces made up of multiple different stakeholders. And the draft plans have gone through a public consultation process with new proposed access management plans, but these are only being done for 2 of the 15 ranges right now. So there's a lot more work to still continue. And a lot more of it needs to be considering the needs of the climate as well. These maps here are, you know, the current footprint in the Cold Lake Caribou Range. So I'm sure many of you in the Fort McMurray region are familiar with this area. And then the proposed footprint in 100 years once restoration has occurred. Oops, excuse me. Sorry. So one of my questions is, would caribou recovery actions move faster if we had better mechanisms for recognizing their impact as a nature-based climate solution? Right now, all of the work to recover caribou and protect areas of the boreal forest is being done through our Species at Risk Act, which is moving excruciatingly slowly, and as I mentioned, fails to incentivize or recognize the added climate benefits. And what we really do need, I think, is additional policy levers to measure, incent, and implement those climate solutions to perhaps also speed up caribou recovery actions. So this is my last slide, and then maybe I have time for questions, but I realize I've gone a bit over time. I just wanted to point out that in a 2019 CEPAWS report called Finding Common Ground, we suggested those needs for policy tools and funding mechanisms to advance those nature-based climate solutions. And part of that is developing greenhouse gas accounting rules that could identify public and private sector players that generate those ecosystem greenhouse gases in Canada, and could start with those activities that do cause land use change, such as forest harvest, exploration. And we really need a way to document that GHG footprint and hold players account, or perhaps incent changed management regimes. So one of CEPAWS's next project has been developing a methodology to determine greenhouse gas emissions from forest harvest and land use change at the tenure level, to perhaps attribute it to forest harvest companies or tenure holders, or inform how and where that harvest is occurring. Other incentives that should be further considered is providing funding for Indigenous protected and conserved areas in ways that would benefit caribou and conserve carbon stores.